Let's begin our panel discussion with Mr. Madhav. We have four panelists with us: Mahi Rathi, Vignesh Venkat, Jaydev Balaji, and Hiranmay Ananda Narayanan. I invite Mahi to start the conversation.
Good evening, sir. I am Mahi Rathi, and I want to say I enjoyed listening to you speak earlier in this session. It also brings up a question in my mind. Sir, as you are aware, the COVID-19 situation has caused a lot of challenges for migrant workers around the world. Daily wages have been affected, health concerns have risen among that group, which has been badly hit. How then do you foresee implications of this situation on economies and on the labor market? And what is the best way to overcome this challenge?
Thank you for that very important question on a contemporary reality that many countries are facing. You are right. The migrant workers are one group of people who have faced certain very serious challenges during this COVID time. It happened in countries like Western Europe, in the countries in Western Europe. But their challenge was different. You know, in Western Europe, this is the harvest season. The fruits, the vegetable farms there, they need workers to come from countries in Eastern Europe to help in harvesting. Because of the pandemic, the travel has completely been banned, so the workers could not go. So they also faced this kind of a challenge. But that challenge, compared to the challenge in the developing world, I would say is a small challenge. But countries like India faced much bigger challenge. In fact, you are right in this, and I know why this question came up in the first place, because you probably must be following the Indian media and you must be seeing the pictures, the visuals of a number of migrant workers trekking for hundreds of miles to reach their home states. I don't want to take too much of your time, but it is important to explain this aspect, because a huge humanitarian challenge is involved in it. India has a migrant population. If I tell you the size of it, you will be wowed definitely. The migrant population in India is just 140 million. That is the size of our migrant population. Out of it, about 60-70 million work within their own state. India has about 29 states, about 60-70 million work within their own state. But another 70-80 million migrant workers travel from their home states to the host states. It is here that the challenge lies. When such a pandemic strikes, if these migrants want to go back, imagine the size of it. 80 million people trying to go back to their homes and hearths, back in their home states. It's a huge, huge challenge for any government. That is why what we tried to do in India was to encourage the employers to take care of these migrant workers, pay them salaries even when there was no work, do not remove them from the roles. Towards that, government has extended soft loan to all the small and medium industries. But together with that, governments have also provided stay, provided accommodation for these migrant workers wherever they are, arranged food, so that these people do not leave their places and embark on a journey back home. Lot of NGOs, lot of charitable organizations also have chipped in. My party, the ruling Bharatiya Janata Party, ruling BJP, has provided food ration to close to 200 million people in last 2 months. All of them are migrant workers, poor people, poor workers. So all these steps taken by governments as well as the non-governmental organizations have helped in encouraging large number of migrant workers to stay put in their places of work. Still, a small section, about 1/8 of the migrant population, decided to undertake a journey back to their places. Initially, we tried to discourage them, but then they set out on foot. Those are the visuals that you all have seen. They are very heart-wrenching visuals of men, women, children walking for miles together. I mean, in some cases, 400 miles, 300 miles by foot, must have certainly disturbed every right-thinking person. But immediately the government took certain steps. Trains were arranged, buses were arranged to transport them to their home states. Why I'm giving you this explanation about this scenario was because it involved a massive logistics challenge. That's why people, societies have to be more humane, more sensitive to the plight of our poor, our hardworking workers. The society also has to care for them. Then only governments can tackle these challenges. I mean, for a moment, because I know the Indian scenario, I'm telling this to you all. For a moment, imagine, instead of about 8 to 10 million people who have started going back to their places, if the number was double, if it was 20 million, even the best logistics could not have been able to cope with that kind of a challenge. So India is now looking into this whole issue of migrant workers in a very, very serious way. It is inevitable that people migrate from one place to another place. They have to be taken care of. So we have to come up with some kind of rules and guidelines to ensure that such challenges or such hardships for migrant workers do not occur again. On a lighter note, not the migrant workers, but students, software professionals, other professionals who are living in a number of countries in the world, including Singapore, have been struggling to come back to India. And again, the challenge for India is that this population that lives in different countries of the world, the Indian population that lives in different countries, is anywhere between 25 to 30 million. How many aircraft should we arrange for it? Is it possible to bring them back? But they all want to come back. Majority of them want to come back. So last 1.5 months, our national carrier, we call it Air India. Air India has been doing only one job of bringing back our workers, our professionals living in different countries. So India's challenges are different. India's challenges, like India's size, are very big. We are trying our best to face and tackle those challenges. Our central approach is it should be humanitarian-centric, human-centric. That is how we are trying to tackle these challenges. Thank you, Mahi.
Thank you very much, sir, for your answer.
Good evening, sir. My name is Vignesh Venkat. I was listening with great interest when you spoke about many ideas for the future. Your optimism is infectious, and I really hope that the situation improves soon. There are certain places in the world that are already easing restrictions, calling themselves COVID-free and planning to open up their borders for normal business. The aviation industry is slowly getting ready to start routes through specific corridors. This comes as good news to many who may be stranded far from their loved ones. How soon do you see these channels opening up for the diaspora, which I'm sure is keen and eager to go back home and be with their families? And what precautions should be taken for safety of all?
Thank you, Venkat. As I mentioned, many of our diaspora friends want to come back to India. We are making arrangements for them to travel back to India. Right now, we are not allowing any international airlines to travel to come to India. We are only using Indian carriers. They can be the official carrier Air India or the private airline services in India. One can hire a charter and bring people back to India. Those things we are doing. But I again advise all our friends, diaspora friends, that there is no need to panic, no need to hurry to come back to India. We are all still having number of restrictions. It is true that we have opened up, because we have to tackle this challenge of pandemic, but also we have to manage the economies of our respective countries. So towards that end, in a controlled way, India has also opened up its economic activity. The lockdowns have been relaxed in large parts of the country. For us, fortunately, about 50% of the country is today free from the spread of this pandemic. Pandemic numbers are rising, but it is contained to a few states, and within those states also to a few areas. So we are trying to manage it effectively in those areas through containment measures, but then rest of the country we are slowly opening up. Economic activity should go on. Look, you all should remember that this pandemic may not go away fully. Today it is a pandemic. Once we learn to tackle it, like if we have proper healthcare establishment developed, if you train people in proper measures, proper precautions, etc., then you will be able to manage it more effectively. Yet it will remain as an epidemic. It's going to be there. So for some time to come, we all have to lead probably a different kind of life. Like, you know, we all have to wear masks. We have to be washing our hands on a regular basis, a number of times in a day. We probably may not be able to have physical meetings. So technology will help people connect with each other. For some time, these measures are necessary. So in this, one needs to be careful, one needs to be patient. Will it remain a phenomena forever? I don't know, because the last time when such a big pandemic happened was about 100 years ago, in 1918. The Spanish flu, they call it. Not to criticize any country, but the name given to that that pandemic was Spanish flu. It took people died in millions when that pandemic struck. But in 3 years' time, by 1920, 1921, the world was back to normal. So what will be the scene in 2021 and 2022? It's difficult to predict now. Maybe everything will be normal again. We'll then be having everything normally. So what I'm trying to say is, for all those who understand that there is a healthcare challenge for all of us, we have to have certain discipline, we have to have certain precautions. So unless it is inevitable, don't plan any travels. Of course, those who want to come back to India, government is making arrangements through our embassies. The embassy, the High Commissioner in Singapore, regularly sends people, those who want to come back to India, regularly arranges aircraft flights to bring them back to India. But as I said, we all have to try and stick to our places. Thank you, Venkat.
Thank you, sir. I speak for many when I say we look forward to the opening of the sky so that normal travel can resume. Thank you, sir.
Good evening, sir. My name is Jaydev Balaji. In this pandemic, Many countries have shown extraordinary resilience in dealing with a challenge so huge. Many world leaders have shown their impeccable qualities to effectively deal with the situation and bring it under control, while many others have successfully led from the front to sail through the choppy waters with finesse and bring their cohorts, be it their country, their industry, or their stakeholders, to safety. What are the lessons of leadership that we can learn from this crisis, and how can we imbibe and improve upon them to benefit the world in a post-COVID era?
Thank you, Jaydev. You are very right. There are a number of examples in this challenging period, especially with respect to leadership qualities. I would say first and foremost should be that a leader's heart should beat for the people. He should really feel the pain of the people. You need leaders who can really understand the difficulties that people face. You know, I don't want to name any leader here, but we have seen callousness on the part of the leaders that has led to deaths in hundreds of thousands in different countries, or tens of thousands in many countries. So first and foremost is for leaders to have real concern for the well-being of their people. Secondly, we need to have robust institutions. You know, again, the experience in many countries is that when this pandemic struck, the institutions have just collapsed. They could not cope with the pandemic challenge. So that is when leaders turn more authoritarian. That is when they turn to military. That is when they turn to harsh measures. But where leadership has paid attention to strengthening the institutions, healthcare institutions, law and order establishment, civic institutions, there we could contain the spread of the virus well. In fact, I gave you the examples of countries like South Korea, Singapore, India, Indonesia, even Australia. Besides the leadership and its good qualities, the institutional support was also very critical, crucial in this whole effort, in this whole fight. But I tell you, most important lesson is that people have to be disciplined. People have to be united. Where this could not be achieved, those countries are struggling today. There are today movements going on against coronavirus, against the measures that are being taken for containing the virus. There are countries in which corona beach parties are happening. Some groups are in a defiance mood. That doesn't help. That wouldn't help. Society has to be disciplined. Society has to be rule-based. Society has to follow certain precautions and guidelines. So the leaders, if they fail to inspire the societies, inspire the people into following certain guidelines or following certain discipline, those countries will suffer. Many, many other lessons one can draw from it. You know, for example, if I talk about India, timely action. If the leader fails to take action on time, then the country will pay a heavy price. Again, I don't want to name any nations, any countries, but if you carefully analyze the response of different governments, different leaders to the pandemic, you will realize that a certain amount of negligence or certain amount of arrogance has caused havoc to those countries. So leaders have to be extremely humble. Humility should be the quality. Your heart should beat for the last man who probably would be the first victim of this pandemic or any such challenge. Then only you can save the lives of the people. Then only you can save the nations. So many such lessons one can draw, especially from the Indian experience. We can draw many lessons. But I thought these are some of the important lessons that we all should learn from this experience of the pandemic. Thank you, Jaydev.
Thank you very much, sir. That was extremely insightful.
Good evening, sir. I am Hiranmay Ananthanarayanan. Throughout your lecture, I have been keenly listening to your thoughts and ideas, and I'm very inspired to imbibe some of these into my own life. Many of my peers and fellow students have already done a lot to make a difference during these trying times. They took upon themselves to do their bit for the benefit of the society in their own little way. For instance, a group of Singapore students did a charity drive for COVID-affected foreign workers in Singapore. Our teachers from campuses in Singapore and Japan have also created many encouraging videos to honor the frontline workers or inspire others to be hopeful. Having done all that, we are still keen to do more for the society. I look to you, sir, to give us your guidance on how young students like ourselves from around the world can make a difference, even if it is from our own homes, and to be productive and useful to the society in this challenging time.
Thank you, Hiranmay. In fact, that is the experience of us in India also. Without the support of the people, even the government of India could not have succeeded in managing this challenge. As you mentioned about your peers and your colleagues in Singapore, same thing I can tell you about India. Ordinary people who probably do not earn their daily bread without toiling for 10 hours a day, even those people came forward to help those in need, those others in need. In fact, our Prime Minister, in his monthly address to the nation called Man Ki Baat. In fact, in his recent Man Ki Baat address, he has highlighted some such examples from a remote state of Tripura in India, remote northeastern state. He cited an example of a pushcart vendor who earns his daily bread by selling vegetables on his pushcart. His business has stopped because of the pandemic and because of the lockdown. But what he did was, from out of his savings, he used to prepare food for 100 people every day, use the same pushcart to take that food and distribute it to the destitutes or the poor people in his place in Tripura. Many such examples show to us that it is the initiative of the people that is very critical to the fight against this coronavirus. So going forward, we all have to understand that this kind of a behavior should not be reserved for challenges alone. Like one may say, sir, I am a very concerned person. Look, If corona comes again, I am ready to serve 100 people. That means for you to be a concerned person, corona has to come back. That should not be the thinking. Whatever I do in my life, the touchstone for it should be as to whether my action is going to help the people or harm the people. Even if it is going to harm one person, the entire logic of profit should not be accepted. You may say, it's all right, sir, one person will suffer, but maybe I will help 100 people. No. That is what is called human-centric development. At the center of your thinking should be human beings. My action should help people. My action, my invention should be helpful to the people. So we have to imbibe that as a natural habit. Concern for people should not be an exclusive quality for certain difficult times alone or for certain people alone. It has to be the natural instinct of all of us. When you go out, when you come across a person suffering, do you feel that suffering in you or not? If you feel that suffering in you, you are a human. We all have to become humans first. Rest everything will follow. We have everything else. We have intelligent people. We have competent individuals. We have great institutions. What is missing is this humane nature. Let us also become humans. That's why I'm repeatedly using this phrase, human-centric development. The center of our thinking should be man. When I say man, that includes woman also. Don't brand me as a masculine or anything. It's the humans. Human-centric should be our thinking in whatever life, area of life you enter into tomorrow. So keep that as the focus of your activity, of your mission. Thank you, Hiranmayee.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you for such a lively panel discussion. The session will now take questions from audience members, which will be read out to Mr. Madhav. The first audience question for Mr. Madhav is from our student, Madhumila Kilamseti from GIIS Tokyo campus.
Hello, sir. This is Madhumila. I truly enjoyed your speech and I learned a lot from it. So you talked about Southeast and East Asian countries for being inspirations for dealing with COVID-19. I come from Japan, which also has managed the pandemic with discipline, just like the populace in India. Just like India, Japan also has a rich culture. And as an Indian in Japan, I am lucky to be experiencing both. What is your opinion on exchanging cultural knowledge between Japan and India to sail through these rough waters? And how can we as students be a bridge between the two great cultures to make a big difference?
Thank you, Madhumila. Again, like your friends and colleagues in Singapore, you are also fortunate to be living in a country which has great leadership and also great people. Like Singapore, Japan also has a history of 7-8 decades. Although it's a very old country, ancient country, the rise of Japan, the modern day Japan, is only about 70-75 years. Great country, great people. You can learn so much from that country. One country which always sees an opportunity in every challenge. Japan as a country has seen so many challenges in its history. Natural challenges, challenges from nature, challenges because of certain wrong leaderships, many challenges. But the Japanese have a very important trait. They learn from every challenge. They don't run away from challenges. They are great learners. In fact, each of our nations, our countries have such great values, great cultural heritage that you are very right that we can exchange between our countries. The foundations of our cultural heritage in the entire Eastern Hemisphere, if we want to call it, has many aspects that are similar, that are identical. The value system of Japan, you will find a lot of similarities of it with the Indian value system. we have grown together. We are civilizational and cultural cousins. We share so many values between us. It's important for us to exchange them. I totally agree with you. And students like you, the Indian students studying in Japan, you can be an important bridge. Similarly, the Japanese students coming to India, they can be an important, they can be the important transmitters of their cultural wisdom to people of India. But let me tell you something more. It is this value system, or I will use a heavy word, it's called worldview. Worldview means the way we look at the world. The values that we all have imbibed in our lives, the values that we all stand for, are the values that are needed for the entire mankind today. So while it's important for India and Japan to exchange the value system, it is more important that together we export this value system to the rest of the world. This approach, this value system of family-centric life, respect for elders, the way we look at the entire creation, entire mankind, for example, whether it is a Japanese or a Chinese or an Indian, we see divinity all over. For us, everything in this creation is divine. That's why we don't hate anyone. Neither because of his color of the skin, nor because of his religion, nor because of any other difference that he probably is having. Because we see same divinity in all of them. This is a great value. This is a great virtue that probably we have to teach to the entire world. That see divinity everywhere. I mentioned in my speech, we look at nature as mother. We worship nature. It's a very important dimension of our cultures, Eastern cultures. For us, this universe, this creation is motherly. We have to teach these values to the entire world. We have to learn about each other, yes. But together, we have a responsibility to tell the world that this is how you have to now look at the mankind, look at the world, look at this universe. Then only you can face the future challenges to the mankind. I fully appreciate the point that you are making, Madhumila. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. That was truly enlightening.
Thank you, Madhumila. The next question is from Sameeksha Srivastava from GIIS Noida campus.
Good evening, sir. It was a great honor to be listening to you speak today. You mentioned that the post-pandemic world is different from the world before COVID-19 and spoke about the opportunities waiting for us. Can you elaborate on the opportunities that we can take advantage of for a new world order? Maybe our students can take some lessons from your advice on how best we can build a new world order.
Thank you, Sameeksha. You are living in India, so you have seen whatever is a lot of things that are happening in and around us in India, in Noida, in Delhi and all over. As far as your question about the future world is concerned, as I mentioned, probably this is an assumption from my side that the new world post-pandemic will not be too so much about bilateral trade or security, etc. Until now, those issues used to be the dominant issues in the world order. I mean, for countries to interact with each other. But the new world will have different agenda items on the table. Now, when I said, environmental issues will be central to new world order. Healthcare will be central to new world order. Technology is going to be central to new world order. In all this, we from the Eastern Hemisphere should emphasize on the issue of human-centric development. So the challenge before you all is that in these new areas, how do you develop systems, models, technology that is human-centric? Now, for example, you today have to think out of the box. Out of the box means, I always give the example of Newton to our youngsters. Newton is taught in all the schools today to teach the gravitation, theory of gravitation. Now, Newton is credited with that theory of gravitation. Did gravitation start with Newton? Gravitational force has always been there in the nature. Newton had actually theorized it. He developed it into a theory. How did he do that? The story goes that he was sitting or lying down under a tree. He suddenly heard the sound of something falling down next to him. When he looked at it, he found a fruit which fell down from the branch. Now, this happens to many of us. If you go to an orchard, sit under any tree, after some time, some fruit will fall down. What do you and me think? We think that, okay, let me just check out if the gardener is around. If he's not around, we'll quietly take that fruit, put it in our pocket, and walk out of the garden. What did Newton do? He looked at the fruit, he looked at the branch, and the thought occurred to him was not about gardener. But the thought occurred to him was, why did this fruit fell down? Why didn't it go up? When it was cut off from the branch, why did it come downwards? Why did it not go upwards? Now, today, if you ask this question to your teacher, ma'am, why do the fruits fall downwards? Why don't they fly upwards? The teacher will tell you, scold you and tell you, have you not read Newton? As if because of Newton, they are coming down. They are not coming down because of Newton. But Newton had the thinking which is out of the box. He did not think like ordinary people. Now it is here the challenge for you all is, can you think differently? The founder of, the founding father of Singapore, Mr. Lee Kuan Yew, read his biography, read his life. He was an out-of-the-box thinker. When Singapore was created in 1964-65, it had nothing. One of the most backward city-states. But it was the vision or out-of-the-box thinking of leaders like Lee Kuan Yew that has transformed Singapore in his own lifetime. He was alive until a few years ago. In front of his own eyes, he could see a developed Singapore. How did it become possible? Why is it not possible in the case of many other countries? Because leader has to be thinking differently. So my appeal, or probably it is a challenge to each and every student sitting here, that can you think differently? Out of the box. So that is the challenge we have to accept today. We need new ideas for securing our environment, new ideas for our technologies, new ideas for healthcare. But we need people who think differently, not those people who only think in terms of their jobs, who don't think in terms of their profits, but those who think differently of helping millions and millions and billions of the people. That is the real challenge today, Sameeksha. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Your advice is appreciated.
Thank you, Sameeksha. Mr. Madhav, you spoke about technology taking over the new order of the world. In this context, audience member Riya Prajapati from Ahmedabad has a question about education and technology. She observes that GIIS Singapore has embraced smart learning and virtual schools for education of students. What are your thoughts on this? and how can India replicate this on a large scale?
Let me tell you all that pandemic or no pandemic, the education sector was anyway undergoing a major transformation in the world before this pandemic struck us. The conventional schooling system was actually changing. Pandemic has only hastened that process. Now, because of the pandemic, institutions are now turning to virtual learning in a big way. This will certainly be a new normal in education sector. The process began much before the pandemic itself. I don't give the credit to pandemic. The process began much before that. That the pandemic has forced all the countries in the world to sit up and seriously look at the much needed reform in our education. It's going to be, as you rightly observed, it's going to be a new normal. India is a very big country. So any such transformation will certainly take some time because India's size, India's needs are much, much bigger than if you compare it with any other country. But definitely, Government of India and the Ministry of Human Resources Development is trying to encourage institutions, the entire education fraternity, to turn to virtual learning methods in a big way. We all have to develop new technologies for it. Because education at one level is universal. Of course, you can develop certain universal mechanisms, but education at another level is very local. It is directly related to the student, the pupil, the person who learns. So there is enormous scope and enormous need for innovation in education today. How do we do that? It is one area in which a lot of thinking and a lot of new experiments are going on in India. In fact, it is one area on which many of you also can do a number of good experiments. First of all, for the teachers, it is going to be a new experience, a new challenge. I know many teachers are very uncomfortable to teach a lesson without seeing the students in front of them. In India, teachers hold a cane in their hands. Unless they beat up a couple of students, that lesson is not completed. In a virtual world, you cannot resort to those techniques. So you have to train the teachers. You have to train the trainers. Then you have to develop technologies. So it is a big transforming area. You all know that a number of online teaching courses have already come up. They're already flourishing. The old system of tuitions, where students go to teachers after the school hours, are slowly fading away. Those activities are being taken over by online teaching apps and online teaching programs. So education is definitely going to be majorly transformed. Post the pandemic, the process that has begun before the pandemic will quickly move forward. We all have to prepare for it, and we all have to come up with a lot of innovations in this area. In fact, that is one area in which you all, the students, have a huge opportunity and scope to come up with a number of new inventions and new initiatives. Thank you.
We have come to the end of the leadership lecture series. Thank you, audience members, for participating with such enthusiasm.